I think first thing I've learned is I needed to be prepared better, but my name is Masud. I'm here from Lancaster University Library. I'll tell you a story about innovation at Lancaster University Library. But when I'm talking about innovation, I'm talking about everything. I'll talk about research, I'll talk about user journeys, ethnographic approaches, all those kind of things. Which makes it a very difficult thing for me to say, because the very first thing I'll have to say, how do you create that? How do you start on that? And everyone is different. I can think on my feet, but a lot of people like to see things written down. So based on that knowledge, that kind of stuff, we started creating a framework. We said, okay, what kind of innovation can we actually deploy at our university, and especially in the library? So we formed four different forms. We started with forced innovation, the one that is actually forced upon us by external policy drivers. You have to do something about open access. You have to do something about research data management. And this bridge is a very good example. It's actually called Tarzan Bridge, so only Tarzan is brave enough to cross it. The second form of innovation we started looking at was exploratory innovation, which is by horizon scanning, more appropriately called by myself as stealing good ideas. And I'll actually give you some examples of that, because we blatantly stole a very good idea from Manchester, so shout out to Manchester here, which I'll explain in a bit more detail. The third form of innovation we were looking at is randomized innovation, where we combine uncommon themes, and uncommon teams. Who would have thought that combining a tree with a raccoon makes the Guardians of the Galaxy? Or having Cheerios and bagels is a good thing. In fact, it is. I've tried it. And the fourth option is actually empowered innovation, things that the university wants you to do. Or, as it was mentioned beforehand, how you can empower yourself to be forefront of that. And we're looking at the top 10, top 100 agenda, and as well as the Digital Lancaster framework. Now, that's great. That sets us in a mode of a framework. But actually, how do we do that? What are the examples of that? And where do we start as well? So I can assure you, there is no good starting point. Start somewhere. That's the best thing I can say. And we started with student-led innovation. So we look after an event that happened at Manchester called Eureka. And we said, that's a great idea. We should steal it. So we did. We called it George the Library. And the idea was that we will invite students to come and give their ideas of doing anything in the library, a very scary thought. We got about 131 different ideas, having a cat cafe, changing the roof, but some really good ones. And the ones that we are about to implement are in these ones. So the winning idea was smart cushions. So a lot of it is about well-being of the students. And actually, these smart cushions will monitor how they are actually stressing out during exam periods and how their posture is behaving at any given time, and will give them indications of taking a break. What's really interesting about this is it sparked innovation across the campus. So we now have a Jolt the Campus running, Design the Spine running, loads of other events in the university. We also worked with one of our graduate trainees to develop an app, or actually participate in developing an app with JISC. And actually, that idea became so successful that he won. So we take full credit for that. Sorry. which is great. And it's something that can be deployed across the board. Another thing we are embarking on is an intelligent building project. So Lancaster University Library has been completely refurbished in the last few months. But what we want to understand is how our users are using the library building itself, what kind of temperature and noise zoning we have. And also, can we give them context-aware information so that it's not just information, but information that's relevant to them. And I'll talk a bit more about user journeys and ethnographic approaches. So we are actually going completely tech. So we've deployed 100 plus of these little beacons across the board. They are on the trees, on the walls, on the roofs, everywhere. And what that monitors is how users are actually roaming through the building and actually help us understand how we need to change certain things to support them. In terms of traditional research, we do standard things, research data management, open access, ORCID, but we are also embarking on an academic impact and citation services unit in the library. Again, we work with SciVal, Insights, we provide custom reports back to HODs and research directors as well. Another thing we are now looking at as part of research data management initiatives is solving real problems. So one of the problems we had was RDM is complex. We can't do anything about it. So we started working on this project, which then was sponsored by JISC, and actually is called DM Online. I definitely invite you to have a look, which brings all the information from your institution into a single dashboard and give you a picture of that. Based on RLUK report on unique and distinctive collections, we are adopting that strategy. We will be one of the first UK universities to buy Magic Box, which can actually give you a digital display of your special collections. We are embarking on our digital library at a very, very rapid pace now, and we want to make sure all of our special and unique collections are showcased. Strongly believe in collaboration. There is a collaboration, there is an innovation group in the library and the innovation hub across the university. We work very closely together. And we do want to cut our cake from a vertical perspective. So our innovation group actually contains lots of people from grades 2s, 3s, 4s, and very few from the senior grades. We are also the first UK university, as far as I know, to develop our campus to scale in Minecraft. You might be wondering, really, what's that to do with research? It's actually a lot to do with student engagement, and the kind of activity and impact we got was amazing. We also got a lot of national coverage, school-based coverage. Lots of schools are engaged now in our efforts as well. Someone said we need to have great staff. I completely agree. So we've run through a large-scale digital fluency exercise for our staff, basically going through 24 hours and how they interact with digital technology. Using that, we are now forming training practices and other things to keep them on board and make sure that their skills are completely up to date. And last but not least, we have built an amazing place to learn in, an amazing place to study in, an amazing place to do research in. The library has been completely refurbished. That in itself sparks innovation. And it's very difficult to say, but when you are in that third space, as it was mentioned before, you actually relax, and that's where your creativity is boosted. Just want to thank you for listening. This is very quick, I understand that. But I also want to end it by saying that innovation is not a sprint. It's a thought process. It's a cultural change. It needs to be embedded in everyone's thinking. And it takes years. There is no quick win in this. So once you've accepted that, things will start changing. Thank you very much.